Tell me about a failure. You got lots of them, right?
Yes. I think we all should. A couple came to mind over time. It took a little bit of time for me to really think about it. I also think Pat Fryman's story was just so good, it kind of makes everyone be like, well, I can't compete with that. So, but the one that I think is really helpful for practitioners, especially to learn about, is I was about 3 years out of school certified, but it was my first job outside of like the university setting. So I had worked at Florida State for a couple of years, and this was my first, like, I have my own company and now this is me working on my own. And I had a really good relationship with a client in the school that he was going to. He was mainstreamed, and I had learned already from other failures at Florida State to be collaborative in the classroom and to work with the teacher and not suggest anything that wouldn't be feasible, and to consider the fact that there were, you know, lots of students in the classroom and those types of things. So I thought I was doing a really great job with all of that. And he was reaching a certain point where he had done well at the beginning of the school year, but things were progressing too quickly for him to keep up. So I was in to do one of my observations and try to figure out, you know, what supports could be put into place to help him keep up. What could we work on at home to practice so that he can keep up, but also like what could be done at school so that he can keep up during the school day as well. And I took my notes and kept them as, you know, again, positive and feasible as possible, like I had learned from other mistakes to do. And I wrote up this really nice, objective, you know, moment by moment report with suggestions of things that would help support this particular student. And I was really proud of my work. I was, you know, pleasantly surprised that there wasn't even a whole lot that needed to change for him to be successful. It was just a few minor things because the teacher was doing such a great job with him. And so I wrote up the report, again, most of it being positive, and then with a few recommendations of supports that he could use. And I gave it to the parent and the school, and within, I don't know, a few days, the school said I could never come back. And the whole relationship just fell apart. And to be fair, like the mom that was the mom of this child was a huge advocate too, so it wasn't just my report. I think it was kind of a culmination of things, but ultimately it was after I turned in that report. So when I was just very confused, why would that happen? Why would they no longer, we had a good relationship, like what's going on? So I showed the report to one of my friends who was a teacher, and she read through it and she said, "Megan, this looks horrible." And I was like, "What? Why? It's objective, it's positive, like I don't understand." And I had just, throughout the report and my objective narration of, you know, the child's day, even though I was saying all positive things, I used the teacher's name a lot. And apparently that was not seen as a good thing. So I still think if I read the report today, I wouldn't even see it still. But basically the idea was the way the report was written, the way that we're kind of taught to write our reports for a classroom, the history that maybe the teachers would have or people outside of our field, it comes off as like too cold and too accusatory, even though all the things I was saying were positive. So when, for the personal experience for that teacher, when she read it, it was more of a negative experience. So I don't even from that failure, it took me a while to accept that. I was just kind of more of like, well, that's a her problem type thing. And it took several years of really working on multidisciplinary teams and seeing how other disciplines like speech language, other teachers, other teacher consultants who don't necessarily have an ABA background, and just other like occupational therapy, physical therapy, the way that they interact and the way that they write the reports and things like that, really helped me get to be more flexible and take a more perspective taking of if this report was about me and I read this, how would that, like, what experience would I have? Before, you know, so when I write my reports now, that's constantly what I'm thinking about, maybe almost too much, but I'm thinking about the people that will be reading this report. How can I say this in a way that will connect with them? And so that they will see that I'm focusing on the child and what we can all do to support the child, and I'm not trying to, like, criticize them in any way. And I use a lot of words that I wouldn't have used previously as a behavior analyst. Sometimes I still cringe a little, but I know that they're words that that person would connect with. And I think about how can I say this for this person in a way that will be meaningful. And what I say for this person is different than what I'll say for a different person over here. I really look at their preferences and kind of what they're attracted to when writing my reports. So it was a failure that I had, I guess with all failures, to learn a lot from, but it took a little bit of time, and I think it's something I'm still constantly working on too. Like, how do we connect best with people outside of our field?